Today is the second day of February 2014, and our dear friend Amal Sircar is with us. Welcome, Amal.
Thank you. Good evening.
We would like to ask, as we do with everyone, how everything began. How did you first hear of Sri Aurobindo and Mother? How did you come to the ashram?
Well, it is a very interesting story when I look back. I used to consider myself at one stage of life that I'm very unfortunate not to have met the mother personal in her physical body. But later on, I realized how lucky I am and how both Sri Aurobindo and Mother is showering their grace on me till date. Well, how I came to first in contact with the mother is very interesting. It was during 1974, October. It was Durga Puja time, the office was closed. I went to the office to check important mails and the signals which come for, you know, aviation for taking immediate action. While I was going through the papers, the letters, I saw three packets and I opened them and I found some red books written, Bulletin of International Center of Education. It was 1974. And when I opened, I saw that mother has left her body, the pictures of her Mahasamadhi, etc., etc. So I put it back inside the envelope and kept it aside, and I found out why this has come to our office. Then I found it has been sent by what Fire X Company of Mumbai to the Fire Marshaller of Civil Aviation Department, and there is no such post. So I said, okay, I can take them home and read. I took the books to my home and started going through it. I saw the mother for the first time in her, when she had left her body with those pictures and other things. I was just going through. Suddenly, I found a quotation which mother has said that an aimless life is a miserable life. The quality of your life depends on the quality of your aim. All of you should have a name. Now, that was a wake-up call for me. I started wondering, what life? What is my aim of life? What am I doing? So I started wondering. But the next thing which has happened was nothing short of a miracle. Those days, there used to be a godman in Mumbai called Dadaji. He had the gift of, or that is called Siddhai, I came to know later on. When he touches somebody, there will be an aroma of flower, which even after you go on taking bath, days after days, it will not go. So one of our deputy director general, a very senior officer, he was narrating to us about this holy man and how he has touched him, and there is an aroma of jasmine all around his body, etc., etc. But somehow, I don't know, unknowingly, I have smiled. And he took exception to that and he asked me, why you are smiling? I said, no, sir. He said, yes, I saw him smiling. What makes you laugh? Smile. I said, well, sir, I know the principle behind how this is done. So really? You know the principles, you can do it. I said, no, I can't do it. But I know the principles behind it. He says, can you prove it? I said, yes, I can prove it. So we went to the VIP room in the Calcutta airport, and I put a book called Autobiography of a Yogi and showed those relevant chapters written by Sri Paramahansa Yoganandaji. Then what he did is nothing short of a miracle. He brought out a wallet from his pocket and showed me a small packet. So he said, "You know this?" I said, "No." "This is a blessing packet given to me by the mother of Sri Aurobindo Ashram. You know the significance of this?" I said, "No." He said, "Well, I was in a meeting, the high power delegation in Karachi, and I had a heart attack, and I died. But the mother pushed me back inside my body." Then again I smiled. He said, "Why are you smiling?" I says, "Sir, excuse me. When you have got the touch of the Divine Mother, you are charmed by these so-called Godmen. Isn't it very cheap?" Everybody was shocked that I am talking like that to a very senior officer. But he realized what I said. After this dispersal of all, so one officer asked me, "We never knew your background, that you are a devil with spirituality." I said, "No, I don't know anything, ABCD. I recently, only last month, I came across some bulletin of international education, and I came to know of the mother." He says, "Are you interested in knowing about mother?" I said, "Very much." He said, "Okay, I will take you to one of my relatives' house." And one Sunday morning, he took me to Madhyam Gram, a suburb of Calcutta. There was a very small house, but very beautiful. And the lady, her name was Jaya Mita. She received me and we sat down. There were two very big pictures of Sri Aurobindo Mother. And I sat down in front of those pictures. They said, I don't know how to meditate and all those things. I just sat down and I was looking at I saw so much of compassion in the eyes of Sri Aurobindo and the smile of her mother. You see, such a beautiful, beatific smile. Then they switched on a tape recorder, those days small tape recorder, and the 1972 centenary music by Sunil Da was played. I kept quiet and I closed my eyes. And I was transported into a world of infinite beauty which I cannot describe. And that day, for the first time, I came in contact with Sri Aurobindo and the mother.
What brought you to Pondicherry?
Exactly. Now, when I was going through this bulletin, I found that the mother has given a lot of emphasis on integral education, on physical education, etc., which is not done anywhere in India, especially in West Bengal, Calcutta. So I wanted my son to be put in this school. So Jayadi introduced me to one of the trustee of Sri Aurobindo Ashram. His name was Pradyut Kumar Bhattacharya. He was the first chairman of DVC and a trustee of Sri Aurobindo Ashram. So I was talking to him and I expressed my desire, can you help me to admit my son in the school of International Center of Education? He says, why you want that? Then I talked about integral education of which I knew nothing. So he listened very carefully and then he smiled. He said, Amal, I find that you are an idealist. You want to make your son perfect in many respect of life, which you could not achieve. But you can't do that. Whatever you expect your son to be, you have to show the way. You have to become. I said, but me, at this stage of life, I know nothing. And he said, it is never too late. And he gave me a blessing packet of the mother. He says, this is the beginning. And he invited me to Pondicherry. And I came to Pondicherry with a young boy named Ranjan Mita, who is now the principal of the Future Foundation School and trustee of Sri Aurobindo Institute of Culture, quite well known all over India. He was a young boy, very young, And I came along with him, with my wife and son. When I came to Sri Aurobindo Ashram, I was amazed that such a place could exist on earth. It was just like a dream. It was like a heaven. And then I started, lamenting, oh my God, what I have missed in life. I could have, if I would have been here before, I could have started a new life, etc., etc. And I started going on lamenting in near the samadhi. And I was expressing my anguish and sorrow and despair to Prabhupada. And I told him that I don't want to go away from this place. I want to be here. So he didn't say anything. He just went on smiling. And I used to go to samadhi and all the time pray, Mother, what crime I have done, what sin I have done, that I could not see you in your physical body, I could not meet you. What is the purpose of my life? I am just wasting. Can't I be of any use to you? Can't I stay over here? Mother, please help me. Like that, I went on imploring. And one day when I was sitting near the samadhi, one lady, totally unknown to me, came and gave me a card. And the card was, these are the words in the card, that those who cannot face the outer realities of life shall not be able to endure still greater battle of yoga. With blessings, Sri Aurobindo. I immediately realized that I was trying to run away from life. I was seeking a safe refuge, a heaven, but life is not like that. So I have to face it. So I calmed down and I just kept quiet. And that day when I went to Prabhupada's house, every day I used to go to his house for tea, and he asked me, what happened to you today? So I told, this has happened. So he had a hearty laugh. He said, now what do you say? I said, sorry, I have to go back to Calcutta. I am not ready. He said, yes, okay, you go back and you will come back again and again. So that's how it happened.
When did you come back to stay for a longer time?
So that was another miracle. Now, when I was going back to Calcutta, I was telling that young boy, they asked me, when are you going to come back? Then I just wondered, I said, if mother wants, I will be back very soon. And I came for the August darshan, I remember. And then he said, everybody says whatever mother wants, but they put their own desire. When you want to come? I said, look, what is the fare? Those days the train fare by the second class fare was much cheaper and all that thing. And I said, if I get this amount of coming and going and staying in Pondicherry from an unexpected quarter, I will board the train the next day. He said, is it? I said, yes. Then I went back to Calcutta. This was sort of a jokingly I said, but I had an office peon and I told him to look after my house. And then I asked him, how is everything? So everything is in order. Then he casually mentioned, sir, there is some money in the office. You better check up with the cashier. I said, what money? I don't have any, you see. And to my utter surprise, I found that exact amount, you won't believe, that exact amount which is required was there. I was stunned. So what type of miracle is this? And well, I took the money. I went straight to the railway booking office and I purchased ticket for darshan of 17th November 1974.
You have often been seen with a great smile greeting people at the ashram gate. Tell us about that.
Now, that's a very interesting thing you have asked me. Now, when I went back from here, I was reading books of Sri Aurobindo and Mother, of which I was not very familiar. So every day I used to spend a lot of time reading the books of Sri Aurobindo and Mother. I must confess that the works of Sri Aurobindo was rather very difficult for me to understand and comprehend, the Life Divine, Savitri, etc. I'll especially narrate something about Savitri. But the words of Mother was very lucid and inspiring. So there I came to know that if one is happy within and make others happy, he is a successful man. Of course, this I read about this particular quote from Ramana Maharshi's statement. But then I realized that what Mother has said, that it is better to be happy than unhappy. Because I find all around me, my relatives, my friends, they are all mourning and complaining about something or other. But I felt that what I am getting is much more than I deserve. So I should be happy. And when I retired from service, I came back here. I gave a letter to the mother asking to serve full time. And I wanted to be an ashramite. I wanted to be a sadhak. But I kept confessing that I am neither a sadhak nor an ashramite. But what I have received from Sri Aurobindo and the mother, I don't think many of the ashramites has received except the old timers. I have not seen mother, but the mother is always with me. And Sri Aurobindo has visited my government quarters 12 times between 81 to 89. That is, the relics of Sri Aurobindo has been taken to my house whenever it went out from ashram to any place. I hope those photographs, this precious memory, and those people like Champaklalji and the Paru and the trustees, whosoever have gone, or the people, devotees, ashramites, those who have gone with the relics, they all said that in a government quarters, they have felt the presence of Sri Aurobindo and the mother. Now, that was a boon. That is a boon which I never can describe. I can never express my gratitude to them, the way they have showered grace. So that made me immensely happy within. And when I applied to the mother that I want to serve you, the next, I mean, few days after that, I was called, but the trustees have decided that I should sit in the ashram gate. So I was very glad. Some people were not very happy. They said, oh, man of your stature, caliber, should sit in the ashram gate like a Darwan. What is this? I said, look, don't talk about all these things. Mother doesn't, she knows best what is to be done. And I have been doing my duty with a smile. And this smile, I think, has, I mean, as you say, many people are happy with my smile. There is a very special incident about this. It was quite late, in about 2-3 years back. I must say that one day while I was sitting in the ashram gate, and somebody, an old man, was staring at me from the near the main gateas, from the side. I felt a little uncomfortable, rather, that why is he staring at me like this? Then he called me. He said, my son, I want to talk to you. So I said, okay. And then I went, he said, you know, I lost my son. He was only 18 years old. And I cursed God. I abused God. I used to say, what have you done to me? Why did you snatch away my only son like that? And I went on cursing. Then I have moved all over India to many temples, many gurus, seeking solace. But I couldn't get it. Then somebody told me about Sri Aurobindo Ashram, especially the mother. So when I came here, you greeted me with a smile. I felt very happy. And when I went inside and sat down near Samadhi, all my sorrows All my anguish disappeared. I felt like a new man. My son, I request you to keep on smiling. That's how I keep on smiling.
Yesterday, we interviewed Shobhadi, and she told us a little bit about the airport and the singing of Om, but you are the one who knows most about it. So please tell us the history of the Pondicherry Airport.
That's also a very interesting story. In 1980s, the beginning, the government of India decided to have an aerodrome in Pondicherry. So a site was selected in Kalapet, and about 80 lakhs of rupees was spent on that. And these ministers, from the central minister as well as the Pondicherry ministers, and they were all talking blah blah that aircraft, jumbo jets will be landing from Paris to Pondicherry and all. I was saying, what the nonsense they are talking about? How can they do that in Pondicherry? It was not it's not possible. But then I came to know that there were two bird sanctuaries, the Ostery Lake and another one, I forget the name, which is a habitat of migratory birds. And Dr. Salim Ali's nephew happened to be an Aurovillian, who wrote to Dr. Salim Ali that this airport is going to completely destroy the habitat of these migratory birds. Dr. Salim Ali wrote to the then Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi, and Rajiv Gandhi gave a telephonic instruction, stop the work immediately, and the work was stopped. So everybody was, alas, what to do? We have spent so much of money, etc., etc. Those days, the chief minister was Mr. Farooq, M.O.H. Farooq, and he was very, very much interested in an airport. So he was pursuing with the minister. So then a new order came from Delhi to explore the possibility of an alternate site. So alternative site, it came to the headquarters, and headquarters sent it to the regional headquarters in Chennai. And our director suddenly called me one day and asked me, Sircar, you go to Pondicherry quite often. Why don't you select a site for an airport? I said, sir, I have no background of selecting a site. I am an air traffic controller. I don't know what to do. He said, no, you will find something. You just go and try. I said, okay. I came and told Duman Bhai. Believe me or not, Duman Bhai just leapt up from his seat, chair, and hugged me. He said, Amol, how lucky and fortunate you are to be chosen by the mother for this work. She wanted an airport all the time. And she has told the minister, Dr. Karan Singh, who used to be coming here all the time, and a devotee, but nothing has been done. It's very strange that you have been chosen. And with all mother's blessings, I said, please help me. You tell mother to help me. He said, of course. And he took me to the mother's room. So I prayed there and came. And then I started working on it. I selected a site, taking into consideration all the possible aspect of noise pollution, like it should not cause noise pollution to Jipmar Airport. It should not cause Auroville, the city, like that. And I made a report. It was sent to Delhi, as it is, without, and with the report, I put it into mother's feet, and then I sent it. And then it went to headquarters forwarded to the ministry forwarded to the environment ministry, and Mr. T.N. Sheshan, who was a very tough man, when he read the report, he approved it and gave green signal. So that's how the airport was sanctioned. At that time, our chairman of International Airports Authority was Air Marshal C.K. Suraji. So he called me and congratulated me for my report. And they said, I want you to be the project coordinator. I said, sir, I have no idea about engineering aspect of making an airport. He says that they are going to do the work, you are going to supervise. Then I asked him, "What, sir? I want some boons." He said, "Boons? The boons are given by the God. I am not God." I says, "To me, you are a God because you are the chief executive officer of our department." He said, "What is that?" I said, "Sir, I want to have direct contact with you." He said, "Why?" I said, "In our government departments, it takes a lot of time for one letter to reach the, and it will be lost, and there, I don't want to lose time. I want to do the work to the best of my ability and possibility, and I can assure you, sir, there will be no superfluous expenditure, etc., etc." He said, "Granted." And this is never done in our department. And he said, "Yes, what is your second boon you are asking for?" I said, "Sir, Pondicherry is a very holy place. Saint Vedavyas has done sadhana where Sri Aurobindo ashram is, and Sri Aurobindo and mother has spent their life in Pondicherry. If you kindly agree, I would like that to give the call sign, radio call sign of Pondicherry Airport, as if it is a VOR, AUM, OM, or if it is an NDB, that's a two-letter call sign, OM, OM. Normally, for the general, I mean, for your information, this location, this call sign is given by the International Civil Aviation of Organization based on the geographical location, like Pondich should have been PY, but not OM. But he said, "Granted." And there was a lot of opposition from different quarters. He says, "You can't have that." But he fought like anything. He said, "No, I have given the word to Sarkar. It will be OM." And even today, the radio call sign of Pondicherry Airport is OM. Anybody who wants to come, they have to send tune their non-directional beacon OM, because we don't have VOR, and that's how they don't hear. They will hear on the only the coded word OM, but it is OM. And I would say it was again a miracle that when this was sanctioned and this everything was there, just few days before the inauguration ceremony of Pondicherry Airport, there used to be a program, regular program in the school compound, and there was a program called OM by Sovadi. And I heard that and I was mesmerized. This was a very long, about half an hour chanting of OM. And I know the efficacy of OM. I'll tell you separately about that. So I requested Sovadi, "Can you kindly sing of this OM on our inaugural day?" Now, it is never done. She has never gone out of ashram ever since she has come to ashram Pondicherry. She, Chinmayi, and two other people, I don't know, remember their names.
Hari.
And another gentleman, I don't remember his name also.
There were four of them.
There were four, and they went and they sang that chanting OM. And everybody was mesmerized. Even I could see the tears rolling down, the governor, the chief minister, and our chairman, they are all with listening with rapt attention. I have a video cassette about that. I'll lend it to Arvind if he can recover, because nowadays those tapes are, I have not played for a long time, but if it can be recovered, you will hear what was the effect of OM on the audience.
Wonderful. Now, Amal, at one point, you were very ill.
Yes.
And tell us about your chanting of OM when you were ill.
Well, it so happened in 1986 precisely, I became suddenly quite sick, and I was coughing very badly, and it went from bad to worse. I consulted many specialists in Chennai, Apollo Hospital and others. Nobody could find anything wrong with me, but I was coughing and vomiting blood. So people thought it is tuberculosis, they did x-ray, nothing wrong. But then what could be? Then I came to the ashram and I was praying the samadhi. One young man, whom I didn't know much, I have not seen him properly, he met me and he said, "Amalda, why don't you come to my house for a cup of tea tomorrow?" I said, "No, sorry, I am very sick. I can't go to anybody's house, and especially I didn't know him personally." He said, "No, no, you please come. We are interested." Anyway, his name, now I will say, was Dr. Bipin Bihari Prasad. He studied, I think, in the school, but he was not an ashramite. He was practicing in General Hospital. And he saw all my medical report, and then he said, "Have they done endoscopy?" I said, "No." He said, "Will you please come tomorrow to the General Hospital?" I said, "Sure." I went there. They did endoscopy, and to their horror, they found that my esophagus, just below the thorax to the intestine, has completely dried up. It has become like a thread. So the food I am taking is not passing through the esophagus, and it is choking my throat, and that's why I am coughing. So they did further examination, and they suspected that I am suffering from terminal cancer. My days are numbered. I won't last more than 3 months. Now, they never told me this, but they told my wife and my relatives. So there was a pall of gloom descended on my family that I am going to die. And at that same time, one day when I was entering ashram, Mona Sircar, he met me. And he said, "Amalda, are you not well?" I said, "No." I must say, those days in 1980s, when I was in Chennai, all the ashramites, most of the ashramites, especially those who were in Sri Aurobindo Society and Atelier, they all used to go to my house and they used to love me because I used to help them in many ways. And he said, "You understand French?" I said, "No." He said, "You please come with me." I went to his house, sat down. He brought a tape recorder and played back the words of mother on the significance of Om. Their mother was telling in French, but to my utter surprise, I could follow it. She was telling how somebody went to Himalayas and chanted Om and he was transformed. And then she herself was chanting Om. And it was it was going into my cell. I was felt some sensation. So then another asked me, "Now you have heard, you start chanting Om." And I went home and I was chanting Om daily, like what you do now in Om choir. But I was not trained, and I was doing it the way mother has shown, that right it should come from the, and I was trying to do it. It so happened after 3 months when I came, I was taking medicine of course, and when I came for examination, they didn't find any trace of my illness. So they were very surprised. And the doctor, he asked me, "What have you done? Where is that? You are the same person." I said, "Well, it looks like so." But he said, "Have you consulted any doctor or anything? Medicine, taken any other medicine?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Whom did you consult?" I said, "Dr. Meera Rishar." He said, "Who is she?" He said, then we've been told, says mother. "Oh, the mother. Oh, mother has cured you." So Well, we can't do it. It is a miracle. Now, I told you that Sri Aurobindo and Mother, they said they don't perform miracle, but in my life, every day it is a miracle. The chanting of Om transported me in such a way that I can't believe. And as I told you, that I am very, very lucky that in 2005, I had a very peculiar symptoms. I was fainting. I fell down near ashram gate with the cycle, and in the medical parlance they call it syncope. And I consulted several doctors and cardiologists. They found nothing wrong and everything is okay. ECG is okay, everything. Then I was asked to go to Calcutta, and when they examined me, they found that my heart is not pumping. It is stopping, and it stopped 4 times in a day. And that day when I was taken to the doctor, I saw his hand shivering, and he said, "You are going to die any moment." I said, "Doctor, I am not yet died. I am still living." He said, "This is not a laughing matter. This is very serious." And I was wheeled inside the ICU, and they implanted pacemaker. Again, after 2-3 years, I was again miraculously sent from Pondicherry to Calcutta, and they implanted one stent. Again, there was a 100% block in my right coronary artery. And 2nd December, today is 2nd February, 2nd December, I have got another angioplasty, and it was in left coronary artery. And again, it is sheer grace that Mother has saved me. There you are.
One thing that is very close to both of us is the love of flowers. And I know you photograph a lot. Would you tell us about your photography?
Honestly speaking, I must confess that I am not a photographer. I shoot pictures just like that because I happen to be here in one of the ashram photographic exhibition, and there were a lot of quotes, and one quote attracted me is that Mother has said, the photography is an art when the photographer is an artist. Now, I am not an artist. I don't know anything. But believe me, it is the Mother who has opened my third eye or the photographic eye, and I believe that the Mother is not in her body, but she is a consciousness which pervades the entire universe. And the flowers are more receptive, and when I enter, suppose, the ashram or anywhere in the world, I find them smiling. So I go on taking pictures. And some of the people, I told Arvind and others, they said, "Why don't you hold exhibition, these, that?" I said, "No, I am not a photographer. I just aim and shoot, that's all." But people have, in Facebook and other places, in the photo.net website, they say that when we see your pictures, photographs, we feel like meditating. Hmm. We find some solace. Now, again, I must tell you, Richard, that this is a grace of Mother. She is revealing herself.
Yes.
That's all I can say.
And today, in the world, how do you feel the action of the supramental, the action of Mother and Sri Aurobindo on all the world?
This is a very interesting question indeed. Now, I must say that sometimes I'm very badly shaken by the events which is taking around the world, all over the world, and in India, the parliament, etc. So one day, I used to be going to Narad. Narad used to be sitting near the beach, and I told him, "Narad, Sri Aurobindo has said that India will lead the world they will be the guru of all nations. What is happening? Where are we? So he looked at me straight in my eyes and said, oh, so this is your faith in the guru. I said, no, not exactly, but the events. He says, the events, the churning of events, everything is coming up. All the things are churning up for a new creation. All the old order will be smashed, crushed. And those who collaborate with the mother and the divine, they will only survive. So I personally feel that now I have redoubled my faith that I do not know about supermind, and I have read about it, but it's just much, much above me. I even not gone through the different levels of mind. But all I can say that what is happening is the work of a miraculous nature. I find the young children, very young, about 3 years old or 2 years old, their IQ is much, much better than many people, and even the scientists are saying that some of the children's IQ is better than Einstein. Now, that means a new order is taking place all over the world. And what we see here in ashram or elsewhere is just a manifestation of a new order coming up, and the old order is crumbling down. This is what I feel.
One thing we had talked about some time back was your reading of Savitri. And tell us about your meeting with Aurobindo Basu and Narad Maran.
You know, I was a student of English literature, and I thought I know something of English literature. But when I started reading Savitri, to my utter amazement, I could not just proceed beyond 7 or 8 lines. I just couldn't understand anything of Savitri. I was going here and there, but I couldn't proceed. I was not understanding what is happening, what the Sri Aurobindo wanted to say. So I was completely lost. I closed Savitri. I said, no, this book is not for me. I came to ashram. And those days, Niruddha used to invite us for a cup of tea. He was very fond of tea, so I used to bring tea from Calcutta for him. And he asked, and Aurobindo Basu and Niruddha, they all used to assemble there, other devotees, at about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and have a cup of tea and direct a lot of exchange jokes and anecdotes, etc. So I sat down. I was a very, very, weeny fellow in front of those giants. So I just asked Niruddha that, Niruddha, I am trying to read Savitri, but I am not understanding it. So Aurobindo Basu reprimanded me, chided me, literally. He said, who told you to understand? I says, well, without understanding, how can I read a book? Then Niruddha, of course, he was full of compassion. He said, Amal, you just go on reading. One day, the secrets will be revealed to you. It has got mantric power. Each word, you go to the samadhi and pray to the mother that this power of Sri Aurobindo be revealed to you in due time. So I went to the samadhi and prayed, the mother, please let me enter into those wonderful world realms of Savitri. Well, immediately it didn't happen. But one day I realized what an amount of treasure we have in Savitri. Each line is so potent with meaning and force and power that it has now become my habit, as advised mother, to read always a few lines of Savitri, and I enjoy immensely. I feel peace, and I also listen to the readings of Saddaban or others who has read Savitri, how to read Savitri properly. And it is a wonderful revelation. It is a different world. I wish more people read and get the illumination of Savitri in their life.
Do you read Savitri out loud?
Yes, I do so. And I try to, I chant it like a mantra, and it helps me. It helps me.
At home chanting you were doing when you were ill, how often you used to chant that, loudly or inwardly?
No, Om, in the beginning in 86 I was chanting loudly. Then I must say I stopped because of pressure of work and all that thing. I was lost. Occasionally I will remember the word Om and I will just go on doing it. Of course, a lot of things have been written in our scripture about Om. I read about it. But practicing Om is a totally different thing. Now, I must say that I was very, very lucky, fortunate to come in contact with Narad, and he took me to this same building upstairs, school building, Om Choir. And oh my God, there we were people sitting together, and they were all, Narad invoked the presence of the mother and he started coming out with Om, and we were saying, and then he said, no, like this it should be. And he could make out the different tones, the different notes, and it created a wonderful atmosphere. And I tried to leave that. It's a world of wonder, I should say, the Om when he invokes and all chants together. It is much, much more powerful than individual chanting of Om.
Amal, one last question. Observation, really. You are always filled with joy and a smile. It seems to me that you live in that joy.
Yes, true. Because how can I express that the mother and Sri Aurobindo is sitting right over there, and that is my happiness, is a spontaneous outpouring of their grace. And there I live in a state, though I am very sick. People say, you don't look sick. But I can't walk a long distance and I will be panting for breath. Today morning, I went to Sri Aurobindo's room because I will be leaving Pondicherry tomorrow. And I was panting for breath, but I would say it is all worth, because happiness comes from within, not from outside. Nobody can purchase, nobody can give. It is a spontaneous grace, it's outpouring. That's why I remind myself that I should never forget for a minute what I owe to thee. And the mother's words, that to be happy is the surest way to express our gratitude to the divine.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much indeed. I consider myself very fortunate that though I have not seen mother, I have felt her love percolating through all the people around me, and she is, I am in her, she is in me.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.